winning. But the last time I checked, my Bible says it's more of us than it is of them. All you got to do is take a look around and see that it's more of us than it is of them. And the success rate is more than you think it is. It's amazing how bad news travels so fast. And bad news is always the news that seem to get to you.
Talk about it, Apostle.
Not only does it get to you first, but bad news has a way of sticking around for a minute. Because I found out that bad news has an assignment. Y'all know that if it gets in the mind, it gets in the faith. And if it settles in my mind, my faith is sooner or later going to grab hold to it. That's why it is important that we understand and we believe and we grab hold to those positive things and those positive people that surround us. The Bible tells us the battle is won and lost in the mind. And that's why it is so important that we stay in a place where we are surrounded around positive things and people speaking life and not death. Bad news has a way of staying around, but I'm honored here today because I'm giving somewhat of a testimony on my in my current situation, because just here recently the enemy has come, and I don't want to give him all the glory, because you can't tell the difference between the flesh and the devil. They work so close to life and they love the same thing. So I don't know, I've got to be honest and say, I don't know if it was the devil, it might have been just me. But I came to a place where I was weak in my thinking, and my surroundings looked like the devil was right. Everything that was happening to me, it looked like the devil was telling the truth. Anybody ever been there? Sometimes your situation will validate what the devil is telling you. It ain't all good all the time. You ain't sitting in a good moment and having all of these spiritual experiences and these high moments and ecstasy and God's presence. There are times when you low and you don't feel like you're really saved anymore. You don't feel like the Christian that left church 5 hours ago. Sometimes you're just in a moment and you're in a mood. And things just feeling like it's just bad. And it's looking bad and it's going to stay bad. But I have a God today. I serve a God today. He loves talking you off the cliff. Right before you feel like you're getting ready to jump off, he has a way of pulling you back into a place. And it don't take a room full of folk to get me joyful again. Sometimes it takes one voice, one text message, one hug, one smile. Oh, anybody know what I'm talking about? You ever been there to get you back in that place where your faith is strong again? I had a moment this morning. But I'm standing in a place of victory right now. And I give God glory. Give him honor. I do want to thank the women of A Power for inviting me to come. And I'm glad that God strengthened me and gave me a miracle moment.
Amen.
To allow me to come and complete this assignment. To bring a word, and I believe that God has a word for us today. I won't be before you long, I really won't, but I want those of you that have your Bibles to go with me to the book of Genesis. And we're going to go to Genesis chapter 38. Hallelujah. Just want to give y'all a little something, because you know, I was really in a place Apostle up last night, and oh, he like, Lord, this child, I done told her 15 times, ain't no thing. Right. But I hit him up again last night. I said, look, just want to be sure. So he said, you know, just let God use you. Just keeping it short. Just let him use you. So mine was going in one direction, and then I heard somebody say, I don't know if it was the lady here, I think her name is Jackie, I don't know who was emceeing, but I heard somebody say, this is our first women's program here at this location. And I was like, hearing the headlights. So I ran to the restroom and I came back, and God gave me this particular word, because I like to be in order.
Yes.
When it comes to what we're doing and what the occasion is. And it's going to apply to all of us. But God gave me a word today to release to the church.
Amen.
And I want to speak from this particular text. And men, it's going to apply to you. If you have Genesis chapter 38, go down with me to verse 6. And it says right there, you don't have to stand. And Judah took a wife for Ur, his firstborn.
Okay.
Whose name was Tamar. Somebody say Tamar.
Tamar.
He took a wife for his son, his firstborn son named Tamar. We'll talk about her. And it says, and Judah's firstborn, check this out, was wicked in the sight of God. Isn't it amazing how some people can get away with righteousness in front of you, but they don't get by when it comes to God? Hallelujah. What looks right to everybody else is wrong to God. Amen. But it says he did evil in the sight of God. And it said, and then the Lord killed him. And then you go on and read it, and it says that Judah was, Tamar was given to the next son, and the next son did something and he died. And then Judah finally believed that Tamar was a curse. And so Tamar had this tag on her, had this sign or mark on her that she was the jinx. Right. Of the church. All right, I want to talk from the topic today. I'm on my way to my next. Can you tell? I'm on my way. I'm on my way to my next. Somebody need to step in. Tell the devil I'm on my way to my next. Here we have the story of a woman that was brought into the tribe of Judah. Everybody already knows that Judah was under one of the tribes of Israel, which is the chosen nation of God. We're going to break it down in today's term. Judah brought her into the church. Hallelujah. Into the church of the sanctified, full of the Holy Ghost, tongue-talking, Bible-believing, all-slanging Christian body of Christ. He brought her into a place to marry her to his son. Now, you got to understand something about Tamar so you can understand the magnitude of her next. It says that Tamar, if you go back and read it, was first of all of a heathen nation. She was brought out from a country that did not serve or worship our God. Y'all know how it is when you bring somebody, or you're dating somebody, or you're friending with somebody who is not of the same belief that you are. Y'all got to understand that it is so very important, hallelujah, that we do line up when it comes to relationships with people who believe the same level, or excuse me, the same God that we believe. They may not necessarily be on the level we're on, but at least they are serving the same God. Tamar came out of this particular idolatrous nation. Second thing is, she was a woman. Okay, y'all already know that women in the Mideast, and even then and now, are considered very, very, very low class, or we'll just say no class. They really have no significance in the eyes of man. The only thing that a woman is good for in this time, in this age, and in this culture is for cleaning house, cooking, and having babies. Anybody know what I'm talking about? They have no real spiritual significance when it comes to the men in the tribe of Judah or in the church. Some of y'all are still the same way you were raised, where you believe in that women don't have a place in the body. Y'all know what I'm saying? Hallelujah. But I'm hell, anything that he chooses. Do you not know that if my God, or y'all know the saying, if he can talk to a jackass, surely God can use a female. Now I want to bring this down for those of you that think that women should be silent in the body of Christ. Y'all got to remember that it was the first gospel that was preached was to a woman. Idea and principles and your doctrine and how you feel God ought to move and who God ought to use and you got your idea about how God should go about manipulating a situation when it comes to revealing himself. But you've got to understand we serve a God that will go to the most, to the things that it said, I will take the foolish things of the world and confound the wise. God said, I'm going to get a hoe off the street and make her your pastor. See, you know, this is the kind of God that I serve. I'll take an ex-crackhead and make them be your prayer warrior. You don't understand what kind of God that I am. But you look at your life, look at your life. So don't tell me who God can and cannot use. Y'all bless him right there. I'm going to get through it. So she was a woman. And she was of another nation. Then she was brought into the church by a male. Now I've got to believe that Judah picked her because she was fine. Now if I got a brother and if I got a sister looking for me for somebody, see, I'm going to give some specifications on what I'm looking for. Everybody got a list. Come on, everybody. Ladies, don't we have a list? See, one of my things on my list is that Negro can't have more than four children. He got more than four, and he ain't gonna holler at me. Don't even talk to him. Because I'm not gonna pay child support till I'm 75. I'm sorry, I'm just not gonna do that. Amen. Love got a whole lot to do with that. Amen. What's love got to do with love? Because guess what? I ain't gonna do that. I ain't gonna pay for your mistake the rest of my life. Y'all might not like me. That's all right. But I'm gonna be real about mine. We got guys walking around here don't want chicks with 15 babies. Baby, I don't want a dude with 15 babies. Let me help you right there. I don't want no Negro that every woman done had. You don't want me because everybody done had me. I don't want you if you done had everybody. Everybody done bit off your apple, baby. I don't want it. Am I helping somebody? So he brought her in, and I got to imagine that she was good looking. She looked very nice, and he picked her for his son. Now y'all already know, you know, Pastor Ballard, you got your sons in the ministry, and they cause these women to bypass you, and you go, mm-mm. Because we see stuff they don't see. You know, we see, you know, love is, you know, the rose-colored glasses. They say love is blind, and it is. Because some, you know, we understand that when we finally get that one, we find that one, and it'll manifest it. You ain't wishing no more. They're in your face now. And sometimes the enemy will send a trick to you. Amen. And they'll send somebody to trip you up. And that's why, you know, we on the outside looking in. And it's always good to let them pass before us so that we can see what you can't see. So anyway, wait a minute. I'm going to go. So Tamar, he brought Tamar in. Let me get to my message. He gave him to his son. And now the Bible says that Ur was wicked in the sight of God. This is the thing that really gets me about us when it comes to church. We tend to judge things based on what we see. Y'all got to understand, and I know y'all have heard this before, but the one that's shouting the loudest is really not the holiest. The one that's seen the best ain't always the one that's tapped in all the time. Sometimes, you know, because the way things are in the building is not necessarily the way things are in their life. Hallelujah. You can be a public success, but a private failure. Your reputation will always follow you. The Bible says that Ur was wicked in the sight of God, so I'm led to believe that he was fooling his daddy. There were some things that Ur was doing that looked right on the surface. Y'all know what I did. I told my church, there is something wrong with your right. The thing that you feel is right in the sight of God, God is saying, baby, you really wrong. That ain't really right. Ain't nothing sanctified about that. Ain't nothing consecrated about that. But to everybody else, you looking like you can buy. You look like you tapped in, but the Bible said that Ur was wicked in the sight of God. This is the thing that I love about God, and I think that we really need to tap into, is that although you may get away with what you're doing in my eyesight,
well,
God is not mocked. That a man soweth, so shall he reap. Now let me help you here. Everybody that's leaving your presence ain't leaving because there's something wrong with you. Some of them are leaving because God is causing them to die. God said they just got to move out of the way. I know as pastors we don't like to see people coming going on ministries, but I've grown to understand and realize there are some people. See, I can't go home and live with you. I can't go home and make you live right for God. But there's a God that follows you in all your ways, and I've got to believe that the God out of my life, that he's doing it for my good. Oh, y'all better help God up in here. Hallelujah. As bad as I don't want to see you go, but there may be a problem, hallelujah, with your life in the presence of God. God can see what I can't see. Y'all better bless him up in here. Don't be mad because they gone. You just have to keep it moving. But Ur had a problem, and it's something how some people don't want to hang around that certain person in the church because they feel like they are the jinx. And the pastor get called in the office and get the text message, pastor, if so-and-so wasn't in your church, I think your church will grow more. Pastor, I believe that if you get rid of so-and-so and sit so-and-so down, they're the reason your church ain't growing. See, y'all don't understand. Sometimes it's the ones that y'all complaining about are the ones that are the most faithful. You don't understand that while you talking about them, God has proven their loyalty to us. Hallelujah. You trying to make me get rid of somebody who's going to stand with me. They really ride or die. But the ones you need to be zooming on, you know, the ones that's shouting all over the place, the one you think is really anointed is the one you really need to be zooming on. Baby, your eyes on the wrong one. Your eyes ain't in tune to CCC. You looking at what you might be getting from them, and that attitude that you talking about and them biting you off a little bit is that they've been with me and they've seen people hurt me, and now they are challenging you. They have put a wall around me, and you don't understand that what looks like a bad attitude is really protection. Hallelujah. What looked like a thing that's pushing you off is really a thing to put you in check. Because, baby, you ain't been on this journey long as we have. Am I talking to anybody up in here? Isn't it something how people will try to point out the jinx in the ministry? They're going to tell you your church ain't growing because so-and-so there. And if you were to put them out, but the baby, y'all don't understand. Hallelujah. hallelujah. We always tend to believe that just because they're the new kid on the block, they're the ones that's going to bring the intimidation. They're the ones that's going to bring the downfall. But you've got to understand, the Bible says that Tamar was brought into this situation. She was married into this situation. And it was nothing that Tamar did to cause death to come into Judah's house, but it was Judah's son. Now there is a flip side to this thing, because there are some of you that we can't watch all the time. And I'm just led to believe that if you gonna curse my ministry, God gonna kill you sooner or later. You gonna die soon. Hallelujah. I ain't got to spend time counseling you all the time. I ain't got to spend my time taking you to IHOP, talking to you all the time. I just believe God gonna be God. And one of these days, I'm gonna look up and you gonna be dead. You just gonna be out the way. Y'all bless God up in here. I'm on my way to my name. Hallelujah. Oh, isn't it something how we try to pick and choose who God picking and choosing, and the ones that are bringing, y'all know the story, the one that doing all the talking. I noticed one thing in this text. Come on. Is that while Tamar was being passed around, she never said nothing. See, here's the thing some of you need to learn how to do, is just shut up. You ain't got to say nothing. If you are right in the sight of God, all you got to do is shut up. Because God gonna fix it eventually. God said, I will fight your battle. See, the thing of it is, I ain't got to cuss you out every time I feel like you done crossed the line with me. All I'm going to do is shut up. And if the pastor want to put me on something else, I'm just going to be obedient and be put on something else. All I'm going to do is just shut up. And I'm going to let God be God. Because I'm on my way. I'm on my way. I think many of you spend too much time trying to fight stuff when all you need to do is just sit down somewhere and let God be God. You ain't God. You think your words gonna change your situation. Hallelujah. When really all the words are doing are changing you. It ain't changing the stuff that's happening to you. It's just changing you. And you're the one, you're the negative equator in this thing. Hallelujah. You're the negative element in this thing. But I found out through this story, Tamar was passed on from male to male. Now y'all got to understand this. She wasn't passed on because of holiness and righteousness. She was passed on because the law said, oh my God, the law said that if she got married to anybody in the tribe of Israel, the law said that Judah would give her to the next oldest brother. Now y'all listen to this. He died without a son. He died without any children. So the law said that Tamar belongs now to the next son. Oh, y'all work with me on this. Now see, there's some things that's just the law. It's just the way it is in here. It's just the way it's been written in here. And you trying to buck it. You trying to change it. But it's just the law. It's the way that APAL functions. You don't like the way APAL doing it, and you need to go somewhere else. It's just the way it is. Am I helping somebody? So now she was passed on. Check this out. She was passed on not for a spiritual leader, but she was passed on for sexual gratification. Oh, somebody gonna get this. See, here's the thing that I found out in church. There are some folk that are passed around in the church. You're not impregnated, but you're used for sexual gratification. Oh my God. What I'm talking about is that there are some pastors in some churches that will pass you around for spiritual masturbation. All they want is gratification that you are shouting. They just want a huck and a buck from you. They could care less if you're pregnant. They don't care if they can bring you to the next level. But they will pass you around because all they do is getting off on your... Y'all better work with me. All they do... I'm on my way to my next. I refuse to sit somewhere and let you use me for your spiritual gratification. You're not finna rub and dry hump me to death. You're not finna wear me out in the spirit, and you ain't giving me nothing. You got the power to take me to the next level, but you refuse to. It says that when Onan got Tamar, that he was glad to have her, but he wasn't gonna impregnate her. See, there's some folk that's glad to have you at their church, but they don't want you anointed. They don't want you in the next level. They don't want to bring you to the next place. And the minute they feel like you getting something, they gonna pull out and spill on the ground. Y'all better bless him like that. My way to my next. See, the thing that I found out. See, the thing I found out is that sex can be enjoyed with your clothes on. I found out that when I was 10, 12, however old I was, me and my little boyfriend, Brian, ain't gonna call it that name since y'all Corey. Me and him were kissing, and we in that dry hop, and we took no clothes off. We ain't doing nothing but satisfying. The flesh was just happy. Ooh, that's good. We ain't did nothing. All we did was masturbate. He used me and I used him. But there was no exchange. See, if I'm in a place and there ain't an exchange going on, see, I've got to believe that all you want me for is for your sexual gratification. You just masturbating with me spiritually. I don't understand why every time I'm getting ready to get my breakthrough, you tend to pull off me. I don't understand every time I get ready to get my breakthrough, the music got to go up. I don't understand why every time I get ready to get mine, it's time to dismiss. Baby, let me tell you something. If you don't take your time with me and really, really rock my world for real and spiritually impregnate me, I'm gonna get up believing that you just used me so you can feel good about what you did, and you ain't really did nothing. Y'all better bless God up in here. They don't want you there for the real reason you there for. God sent me over here. God sent me over here to get pregnant. God brought me over here. He brought me out of idolatry into the real church for you to dry hump me.
No, we don't dry hump us.
For you to just get excited because I'm jerking and I'm shouting and I ain't elevating. I still can't get a prayer through. You ain't teaching me how to talk to God. You ain't telling me how to discern devils. You ain't teaching me how to pray for myself. I got to believe that you just dry humping me. You using me to get off. You using me to make yourself feel good. But you ain't giving me. Y'all better bless him up in. See, here's the thing. Onan was okay with the law that Tamar could be here sexually. But he cut off what God said she's given to you for you to impregnate her. And that you're giving her is not going to belong to you. Let me talk about this. See, there's some pastors that don't want to impregnate you because they feel if they give you too much, you're going to leave and take what they gave you somewhere else. And see, you can't be intimidated if they got the prison ministry in them. Your assignment is to impart in them. There is a transaction. You're to release your seed into me, so that you can bring me to the next level in my assignment. But if you only use God's word to satisfy your flesh, you're going to die soon. Because the Bible says that when Onan got up, he did what he wanted to do, but he pulled out and he spilled on the ground. See, you can't take God's word and make it work for you. It ain't part of the way, it's all the way. And the Bible says that only did it one time too many, and the word of God said, and God killed him. I'm on my way to my next. I refuse to be a pawn in your nasty, dirty, perverted schemes. You're not finna use me to gratify your flesh. All you want is my offering. All you want is my shelter. But you are supposed to empower me. You're supposed to bring me to the next level. And every time I get ready to get mad. It's time to open the doors of the church. Can you pick her up? Anthony, you stop playing right now. I feel the spirit of, and I'm talking parent. I feel the spirit of the Lord say it's time to move on. Oh, wow. But somebody's right here.
Right. My God.
They're open. They're ready to receive. They're right at their breakthrough. And you too selfish.
Come on.
You so selfish. But here's the thing. Judah found out he wasn't the one with the power. He was passing her around, but God had her.
My God.
See, sometimes the way to your next don't feel like the right way.
Talk about it.
God, I've been to church after church, and I've been hurt. I've been used. Couldn't get a meeting with the pastor for nothing. Couldn't even steal 5 minutes in the hallway. Because the bodyguards wouldn't let me near it. And so God, I just got to believe that this ain't what you chose for me. Why am I here? Is it just to help fund the ministry? Am I just another number in the chair? Or did you so that I can be brought into my next, so that I can be a purpose and be of use for you in the kingdom? This is why. I can imagine tomorrow was heavy.
Yeah.
Because it said that Judah told her, look, honey, I got one more son.
One more.
You ain't been getting it.
Right.
He didn't say that, Papa. He said, look, he too young.
That's what he said.
Go back home to your dad. And see, here's the thing. Isn't it something how people, you brought me to the church. And now you want to send me back where you brought me from, worse than what I was when I left. See, it's one thing to leave and move out your town or your city, but then when you got to go back more broken, dog, tomorrow we heard you was passed around over there. Don't nobody in this tribe want you, because you done had every man in Judah's house.
Whoa.
Y'all gotta understand, when a woman been touched over there, she's disgraced.
Right.
It ain't like America.
All right, man.
He was sending her back worse. See, how is it possible that I leave, I come, I'm brought to the house of God, and I'm sent out in worse condition than when I came? There is something wrong with that picture. And the head of the church, who has the power to elevate me, won't.
My Lord.
And check this out. Here's the thing.
Yes.
Judah had the power to silence everybody.
Yes.
See, let me help y'all here. Nobody wanted anything to do with Tamar because Judah didn't. See, that's why as pastors, we can't let y'all know who we really ain't fitting. Because y'all gonna change how y'all feeling. I know I'm helping somebody. I can't express myself openly to my folk that's around me. Because y'all gonna start treating them different. And you got to know that Tamar was treated bad because Judah treated her bad. Do you not know all it takes is for your leader to say, don't do that. Don't say that. No, I'm not going to listen to that. Don't do that. Because here's what I do. Let me bring you back to when you were the woman that everybody was talking about. Let me bring you back to the woman nobody couldn't stand you. Let me say this. I'm going to be done. The way to your next doesn't always feel like it's the way God really has chosen, but it's the way. There are some things that you have to go through on purpose so that when you get into your next season, when you break through in your next, through your next portal, you done brought all this testimony. You brought all of this sacrifice. You brought all of this. And it's I'm just, victory, the highs and the lows. You brought it all with you. So when you come out, you got something to look back and say, you know, the thing that I figured out about my life, Val Tidner as Pastor Val, is that there are some paths and some places and some testimonies and some things that I've gone through and yet to go through. I wouldn't have chose to go that way.
All right, yeah.
Say that.
But it's the way that God purposed me to go.
My God.
And tomorrow. See, this is what I love about change. Don't look like change when change is happening.
All right.
Change feels like trouble. Because it's change. When there's a shifting, we think change is supposed to feel good, but change don't feel good. Honey, when I was coming into my puberty, these little beast things was hurting. I didn't know what was going on. My body was like, meow, meow, and I'm like, oh, I'm hurting, lady.
Right. Yeah. Yes. Amen.
And mama said, baby, don't worry about it. You just growing up. I don't like this. Why Daryl ain't going through this? Baby, he a boy. I ain't understanding that because I ain't liking it right here. They hurt.
Right. He has
more of that
too.
Amen. I know y'all. And it ain't just a. It ain't just that. They go, yeah. They go. But you know what I found out, and I am done. Give me something. Because we have been brought into a place of life and transition and resurrection. You're in a kingdom, you're not in a world. And the thing that you've got to understand and wrap your mind around in the kingdom is that it does not operate like the world. There are some things that just don't seem right. But it's the will of God.
Yes.
I found out that there's a time when God seems to be this paradoxical God. He don't make sense, he makes sense. He makes sense, he don't make sense. He says, give, and I should get back. The world tell me to save. I should have plenty, but God said, no, give. The Bible tells me to die so I can live. The world said, live, and you don't die. And it just seems like God doesn't make sense sometimes. The things that he allows us to go through. But the thing that all of us need to realize is that God brought us here for a purpose. There is a plan for each and every one of our lives. The thing I love about Tamar is that she prevailed. He's tried to send her back, but she got to know Judah. So I didn't get to this part of it. Judah had lost his wife, but she knew Judah was sexually high strung. So she decided to put on some more clothes while he was on his way to church. And she sat there because she know Judah ain't had none in 6 months. She go back and read the story. So she sat by the way. You might not have got me, you might not have brought me to the next level the right way, but you finna bring me to the next level. I'm gonna trick my way up into my breakthrough. See, that's why sometimes you can't be determined to depend on other people to do for you what God would give you the power to do yourself. Even if I gotta trick a nigga to do it, I'm gonna get my elevation.
All right. Get it now.
Can I say that? Can I say that? I just said it today. It's out there now. But what I'm trying to say is that we can't sit back waiting on folk to bring us to this next level in God when you possess the power to get it yourself. Some of you sitting down waiting, I'm there waiting on my breakthrough. Why you ain't doing nothing again? I'm serious. I'm waiting on a job. Hey man, I heard you looking for me.
Don't work like that.
You know what I found out? I went through a season in my church where my church just we were barely making it financially. And I'm sitting there going, Lord, I ain't got no money. God sent one of my folk to tell me, you got a store in your closet.
Yeah.
I got a shoe room.
Yeah.
Not a shoe closet. I got a shoe. I got over 200. Here's what I'm trying to say. My closet is color-coded. They call it Macy's Junior. I want to wear green, it's green. I want to wear yellow, it's over here. I want to wear orange. Everything is separated. My suits, my dresses, everything's. And I got every closet in the house. God said, why you sitting up here talking about you ain't got no money? You got a store. Because some of this stuff up in here, you ain't going to wear no more. Look up in that tags. Come on, ladies.
Amen.
Shoes still got the tags on. Oh, I forgot I had these shoes. So what I started doing, I had a yard sale and made over $700 in my church. I wouldn't even know where else. My church, like, Pastor, this in my church. They don't tell everybody came. And it started a business. See, here's what I'm trying to say. I told my, there's an entrepreneur spirit that some of you need to grab hold of. Y'all know them dollar store earrings up in the beauty supply store? You paying a dollar for them? Somebody pay two for them. I'm serious. One of my members started her business. She took $10 with about $10 pack of earrings, went to her neighbor, because I said every beauty supply store will have the same earring. You tap into that resource, that thing that you like to do. And now, this woman is sewing into my life every week financially. She goes to the flea market, got a table. She went from selling earrings to selling jeggings and eyelashes. She tapped into her neighbors. I'm serious. And she's doing good. One of my other wait on God to do this thing. When God said, I've given you power to get wealth. You know what I really wish I could tap into now? I sell out every time I get men jewelry. My men bought all my little bracelets and stuff. I wish I knew what men really like to wear. My nephew said,
I'll let apostle.
You got any more jewelry for men? I ain't bought none. I'm just like, you'll be surprised. I'm just saying, you'll be surprised at what God will really do through you. It don't take money to start a business. It just take courage. You got a little faith and a little courage. Because think about it. I done picked up many dresses, many pair of shoes. I'm like, shoot, I done paid $250 for these. They asking but for $99. I'm thinking I got a deal. I'm serious. Yeah. So if you don't pay more for them, somebody else will. Yeah. Tamar went, and she got impregnated by Judah. She got for herself what he refused to give her.
My God.
So now, she had a child that was in the lineage of Jesus Christ. Y'all know the story, Perez. Y'all know it. And they lived happily ever after. I'm going into my next. My next is here. Come on and give God praise right there, ladies.